me today from Bloomsbury, I'm joined by Nigel Newton. Nigel, welcome back.
Thank you very much.
You've had your interims out recently, the 6 months here to the end of August. First off, just talk us through how business has been here. You've seen pretty good growth in both segments of Bloomsbury.
Yeah, I think it was one of our best first halves of the year ever, because we are traditionally a second half-year weighted company. So we saw 122% growth in the profitability of our adult trade division, 107% growth in our non-consumer division that contains academic and professional. So that was a pretty great result. Overall sales were up 4% and profits were up 13%.
Well, as you point out, adult trade did especially well in the period. What were some of the drivers behind that?
Well, we had a great period. First of all, there was a movie of the Guernsey Literary and Potato Peel Pie Society starring Lily James just before her performance in Mamma Mia 2. This is a novel by Marianne Schaffer we published 10 years ago, but it was propelled back into the bestseller list by this great movie. That was one thing. The second thing was that the great novelist Camilla Shamsie won the Women's Prize, which used to be known as the Orange Prize, for her novel Home Fire. So again, lots of extra sales. A brilliant book called Why I Am No Longer Talking to White People About Race by Renee Edo Lodge. That sat most of the summer in the paperback bestseller list. So the crowning moment was in July when the Man Booker Prize held a Booker of Bookers, the best Booker winner of the last 50 years, and the judges picked The English Patient by Michael Ondaatje. So those were some of the reasons why we had a really great first half in adult trade.
And as you've just illustrated, there's so much more to Bloomsbury than Harry Potter. But the series, that's still doing quite nicely, still growing.
Fantastic. So we were amazed that we saw 5% growth on the sales of Harry Potter over the same period a year ago, because 1 year ago was the 20th anniversary of Harry Potter, and there was a huge amount of interest. But the phenomenon goes on, and there's a new film, A Fantastic Beasts 2, opening shortly. So, and the best thing of all is a new illustrated edition of The Tales of Beedle the Bard by J.K. Rowling, illustrated by Chris Riddell. A fantastic book.
Give us some more detail about some of the highlights in non-consumer. I know you had a couple of new resources.
Yes,
released.
We did. So we're building up digital resources that we sell on a subscription basis to university libraries. Think the Churchill Archive Online, 800,000 pages of writings from Churchill's lifetime, used by scholars around the world. So we added several new digital resources, the Bloomsbury Design Library, to name but one. In the year, we added a new module to Bloomsbury Fashion Central called Fashion Business Case Studies. And later in the year, we are launching the Bloomsbury Architecture Library next year, based on Sir Banister Fletcher's magisterial work on architecture. So the growth has been terrific in the digital resources division. For our shareholders, it gives steady annuity income as university libraries, rather like a journal, they renew their subscription every year to these products.
And of course, you had the acquisition back in April, I think it was, of IBT.
That's right. So IB Taurus is a fine academic publishing house with a strength in philosophy, theology, and particularly noted for its list in Middle Eastern studies. And so we acquired them, and we're integrating them into the larger Bloomsbury Academic at the moment. And it's going to provide some wonderful new scholarly works to go into the Bloomsbury Collections, which is one of the academic digital resources which I mentioned.
Certainly a lot's been happening. And of course, we need to talk about some of these nice partnerships that you've agreed to in the period. Spotify, was Net-a-Porter also one?
Yes, that's right. So with Spotify, we've done a deal where we've licensed the audio rights in about 130 academic books about individual rock albums, which they will be turning into premium audio content with music and voice from the books for music fans who are obsessive about their favorite band and their favorite album. That's one. We've done another one in a fashion photography archive with Yuke's Net-a-Porter, which will also be an add-on digital resource at Bloomsbury.
And just this week, you've announced a five-year deal with the Institute of Chartered Accountants of England and Wales. Tell me a bit more about what's involved here.
That's right. Well, we're making available through the ICAEW, or they are making available to their own members, the tax information in a wide range of Bloomsbury professional tax publications. So it's a groundbreaking deal if you are in a category of membership at the ICAEW. You will have access for free as a result of your membership to this material that helps you get your job done.
Well, before we talk a little bit more about what you've been up to in the second half here, as far as the dividend, interim divvy up 5% in the period here, Nigel?
Well, that's right, and we're very proud of our dividend growth record. You can see it there, and we are I think within a year of 25 years of consistent dividend growth that I understand will make us termed a dividend aristocrat.
Very good. So as far as new titles, what can we expect?
Well, in the short term, the picture is really rosy because we've got Tom Kerridge's Fresh Start coming at the end of December. To remind you, our year ends in February, so we hope for two fantastic months of sales before the year end of the new book. It ties in with a BBC Two television series right at the beginning of January. You may remember that last year Tom had a book and TV series called Lose Weight for Good.
That's
on
right.
Exactly the same time frame. In fact, that book forced us to issue the first ever profits upgrade in the history of Bloomsbury as a public company because the market is so huge. Tom Kerridge is clearly the new Jamie Oliver, and he has the most wonderful gift, not only on television, but of writing books.
And on the non-consumer side, what have you been focusing on for the second half?
Well, we've been focusing on this ICAEW deal. Mm-hmm. We've also been focusing on our wide range of some 1,500 academic monographs that we publish each year. We've been focusing on finding new content for our digital resources. We've had some big successes. We've launched a new module in the Arcadian Library online about Turkica, and are seeing great interest from universities with Middle Eastern studies courses around the world in this. So it's going to be a really exciting period in the academic and professional side of the business.
I bet. And as you said right at the start, as usual, you're expecting the numbers to be second half weighted here. So anticipating a relatively busy 6 months.
We are, and in fact, we're 2 months into them. And I'm not telling tales out of school in revealing that possibly the biggest book of all, other than Tom Kerridge, is Sarah J. Maas, her new title, Kingdom of Ash, which was published 2 days ago on Tuesday, and we've just seen the first stats through of the day one sales in America, and they were double those of her previous book. They were well over 40,000 on day one compared to about 20,000 on day one of the earlier book in the same series. So there's great excitement back at Bedford Square and at 1385 Broadway about that, and at George Street in Sydney, where Sarah Maas is also a huge phenomenon in Australia.
That's great. Nigel, thanks for your time. Nice to see you.
Thank you.